It was wonderful. It was really, really wonderful. It was one of those jobs that you dream about doing, and then before you know it, you're doing it, and then it's a dream the whole way through. It was really, really quite surreal. New Zealand is the most beautiful place in the world, I think. It's gorgeous. And you're sort of charging around with a sword and like fighting demons left, right and centre. So it's pretty surreal and wonderful, really. Yeah. I must confess, I didn't know of Terry's books before I had to audition for it. But as soon as I got the audition, I went and did all my research and looked into his work and thought it was wonderful and fantastic. And I read the books and I also got the audio books. So I was sort of drowning myself with the ears and like reading it as much as I could and completely immersed myself in his world, which is, yeah, well, it's incredible, as I'm sure you all know. Yeah. When I got the breakthrough, when you join an agency, your agent gets you auditions and you get the breakdowns for each job. So I knew it was going to be MTV. I knew that they were Terry Brooks's books. I knew that it was going to film in New Zealand. I don't think I knew that any other actors were attached at that point. So I knew bits. What makes this show so special is the fact that it is a slightly unique, like, unobvious choice. I mean, you'd never think to go to MTV to create a fantasy fiction series, but they've done a remarkable job and they've put so much time and so much money and so much attention on this job, on this series, and I think it really pays off because you can see, I mean, visually it's stunning, it's film-like, and everyone says that when they watch it, is that it resembles sort of Lord of the Rings and The Hobbit, and it takes after that more so than your normal TV series that have a slightly lower budget and don't pay so much attention to the CGI and the special effects. So it does seem a much larger scale and a much higher budget for the sort of TV series that it is. Well, I just fell in love with her, really. As soon as I started reading it, I mean, every time you read a script, you naturally want to identify with the character, because ultimately you want to see yourself playing that character. But as soon as I started reading it, more so than lots of other scripts that I'd read, I felt so connected to her and her journey and her desire to find strength and her vulnerabilities. And she's this wonderfully well-rounded character because she's trying so hard to be strong. And she's got all these insecurities and all these doubts, as we all do, because she's not human. I was going to say she's human, but she's not. She's an elf. But that's what made her so personable to me, is that I could really see myself in her, and hopefully lots of young girls can see themselves in her. And I think that's what's so lovely about her journey, is that she starts off as this very sheltered, very precious, very mollycoddled little girl in this palace, and then she goes on this journey and she becomes this strong, powerful warrior and has to save the world, which is a huge task, especially on such young shoulders. So for her to take on that challenge and succeed in that, I think is absolutely remarkable. And if I can get the message across to young girls that they can, you know, if they can be inspired by her story and know that, you know, they shouldn't feel that they are inferior in any way, regardless of, you know, if they feel inferior because of their sex or because of their gender or because of their, well, it's the same thing, but if they feel inferior for any reason, they shouldn't. And they should try to not feel like that and try and push forward anyway, because everyone has insecurities and everyone feels as though they have barriers that they need to overcome. And we can just all do our best to try and break through those, I think. Well, that was the first bit that grabbed me in the script. I mean, the opening section, she's running the gauntlet, which is this competition that's exclusively for the males in the community and in the society. So it's a massive, massive moment for her just to be taking part, let alone the fact that she then goes on to win and become one of the chosen few who get to look after the Elkries. So it's a huge moment for her. And obviously she's doing this, and she hasn't let her grandfather know, John Rhys-Davies, who plays my grandfather, he had no idea about it. So it's an enormous moment for her. And I think that's a real changing point for my character, because it makes her realise that she is capable of what she feels she's capable of, even though everyone else around her completely dismisses that and doesn't think she's able to. she fights against all prejudice and proves them wrong. Well, I'm not terribly good on a horse, so that was a personal insecurity. I hadn't done any horse riding before I got out there. So we had 3 weeks before we started, and we did horse riding every day, we did sword fighting every day, we did stage combat, we had a personal trainer who was this ex-cage fighter who would sort of train us up and make us really, like, staunch and bulky and, like, yeah, pretty badass by the end of it. But the horse riding was a bit of a challenge for me. I also fell off the horse, which didn't go down terribly well, as everyone was probably, well, they were very worried about me. But I was fine, and I survived to tell the tale with a few bruises and bashes and scrapes. Our series is set in the future, for one. So they're not your old, ancient, elven creatures as such. I mean, this is post-apocalyptic, so this is set thousands of years in the future. So I think there's elements of our human world that we know and live in today in their world, which is quite interesting, because there are certain bits that you notice that you go, oh, I recognise that. Like, there's an iPad, for example, in one of the scenes, and you go, oh, as a viewer. Well, I imagine you go, oh, because that's how I would react if I was viewing it. But there are little things like that that I think set it apart from your everyday, not your everyday, I shouldn't say that, but your other things that, you know, incorporate elves. I know everyone says this, and they all say that, you know, you're a family and you bond, and everyone does, but I feel like we bond the most, if I can say that. No, we did just become this huge family. He's the most incredible man and actor, obviously, and someone I looked up to hugely, so to finally get the chance to meet him and work alongside him was incredible. And yeah, he would sort of take you aside and drop little pearls of wisdom in your ear. So you just felt like you were this wonderful sponge on set every day, and you were just trying to soak up all his knowledge, because he's such like a, just, you know, temple of wisdom, that man. He's amazing.
Can you give us an example of what he would whisper in your ear?
One of the things he taught me was that he hated my signature. He didn't like the fact that my signature was really squiggly and squirrely. Because he said, you know, when a fan wants their signature, your signature, they're going to want to be able to recognise your name. And I was like, okay, well, this is my signature. And he went, you can't see what that is at all. And it doesn't say Poppy Drayton. So I was like, oh, okay, John, I'll try and go home and practice and do a different one. But that's a really poor example, because he also taught me lots of, like, important things too. But that's just the first one that came to mind.
What was your favourite day of shooting? Was it a particular day where you're shooting horseback
or
you're fighting?
Gosh, that's really hard.
Sorry.
Because there are so many. No, it's a nice one because there are so many. There was a scene in the very first episode where I'm in a waterfall, mm-hmm. and I'm sort of washing myself, and it's all very quiet and there's no one else there. And bizarrely, even though it was one of those scenes that you sort of go, ooh, God, I'm going to have to do that, and I'm going to have to be pretty naked in front of some people, and that's embarrassing. Yeah, exactly. But actually, it turned out to be the loveliest day. There was a really minimal crew, and there was something about being under that cascade of water in the middle of New Zealand, pretty bare, just going, oh my goodness, this is quite remarkable and strange and wonderful in a weird way. So yeah, maybe that day. Well, I think it's really interesting because, and Terry was really behind us the whole way with this, because he understands that they are two completely separate mediums, and what a viewer or a reader demands in one can't demand the same thing from a TV series. So because you don't have the luxury of time, and you don't have, I suppose just time is the main thing, people are going to want things faster, and they're going to want something more dynamic, and they're going to want something more dramatic, essentially, because they don't, you know, a book you can pick up and put down and sort of do it at your own pace. So there are quite a few differences in our series to the books. I think one of the things that I really enjoyed about the TV series was that Amberlee's character really grew in quite I mean, she's a lot more of a badass in the TV series than she is in the books. She's a beautiful, beautiful character in the books, but she's a lot softer and she's a lot more gentle, and that's beautiful. And I really wanted to keep that essence of her when I went to, you know, when we started working on the TV series, because that's such an integral part of her character. But in the series, they really wanted to show her as a really empowering young woman at the same time. And I think they really found the balance there. And I tried my hardest to find that balance too, in order to, you know, keep the nature of the character alive, but also to make her that bit stronger and that bit more 21st century. So
it's in a post-apocalyptic setting, and there's sort of things from our universe that you see in there. It's something that's only kind of vaguely alluded to in the kind of earlier books of Shannara. Do you think it was the right decision to make that a bit more blatant in the TV show than it was in the books?
I think so. Just because, as a viewer, I think those are the little details that you really appreciate when you're watching, and that you can sort of identify with. And I think whenever you're watching anything, all you want to do is go, oh, I do that, or I react that way, or, oh, that's exactly how I feel. And you long to feel some sort of connection with something that you're watching. So, yeah, I think it does help, and I think the more of that, the better, really. They're all very interested in my little elven ear tips. And I saw a few people with them on, and I was like, oh, I didn't even get to keep mine from the show. And I was like, how did you get yours? So, yeah, they're very interested in the ears, very interested in how long it takes for the ears to get put on and what they're made out of and all that sort of thing, and also what New Zealand's like. So, yeah, it's fun to answer their questions. And it's so nice to see the fans as well face to face, because that's what you're doing it for. That's who you're doing it for. So to really see their excitement on their faces and to see their wonder and their desire to learn more about your show is just such a precious, precious thing, and something I'm extremely grateful for.
Filming in New Zealand, do you the fan thing yourself? Have you been around and found Hobbiton and done all those kind of things yourself?
I didn't. That was the one place I didn't manage to get to. I ended up staying on in New Zealand for a little bit longer after we finished filming, because I realised that although we'd been to all these different locations, that I hadn't actually seen much of the country. So it got to the end of filming and I was like, I can't leave. I haven't done New Zealand. I have to go and do New Zealand. So I went down to the South Island and I did a skydive and went on a helicopter trip and did all these things, because I felt at least then I'd sort of, you know, calmed my urge to see everything and to do everything. So, yeah.
I mean, you mentioned fans always want to know about the ears. This is your perfect opportunity. You've got the world's press here. Answer it now. Put it to bed.
Tell us about the ears.
How long does that take?
Beginning and end.
How does it feel?
They're pretty great, actually. They're made of silicone, and they're disposable. So every day you get a new pair of ears, which is pretty great. And they take about 45 minutes to apply. And I could take you through the whole process if you like. But they're glued on to your ear, and then they have to be taken off at the end of the day. Mind you, John Rhys-Davies, he would always be very naughty, and he would just grab his ears at the end of the day and just rip them off, which he would take much delight in, because it would really annoy the makeup girls who would be there ready with their alcohol to take it off naturally and like do it properly, the proper way. So I did take after him sometimes and rip them off if I was feeling particularly rebellious that day. But yeah, it was wonderful. And then there was another thing that they used to do in the water. They didn't really react well to all the water, so they'd sort of droop and they'd become these little like little puppy dog elven ears, which wasn't really the look that MTV were going for. So we had some emergency ear moments those days. I just finished working on A Little Mermaid, which is a new independent American film, which was fabulous. I got to be in a full prosthetic mermaid tail for 3 weeks, basically, and got to go to a mermaid park and swim around and do. I did have scenes above the water, so don't worry, I'm not under the water for the whole film. A lot of people go, oh, did you do your scenes underwater? And I go, I don't even know how you do that. But no, I was above ground with legs for a lot of it. So.
And that's obviously a story that captures people's imaginations for generations now. What do you think it is about that seems so timeless that keeps us coming back to it as a story?
Oh, gosh. That's a very good question. I don't know. I think it's maybe the fascination with mermaids. I mean, every little girl has sort of I definitely did when I was a little girl. Maybe you didn't. But I had a huge fascination with mermaids and always dreamt of being a mermaid. And I know my sister did too. She's there agreeing, going, that was me. But I think every little girl wants to be a mermaid. So there's that. And it's such a sweet story. I mean, ours doesn't follow the story exactly. It doesn't follow the Disney version. But, yeah, there's a real beauty to the storyline that they tell.
Mm. And when you've been part of a big sort of production series like this, is it a different experience to go and work on a small independent film?
It is, yeah. It is quite different. Obviously, the budget's smaller, so you've got to all sort of galvanise together, and there's a real sense that you're in the trenches and you're doing it, and, you know, you're battling against the elements and all sorts. So there's much more of like a, we need to, by hook or by crook, get this done. Whereas on a TV series or on a larger scale production, you have more money and you have slightly more time sometimes. So there are different things that take priorities over others. Yeah, but yeah, they're both wonderful in their own way. Just thank you. Just thank you for watching it, and I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope you continue to enjoy the series.